would like to try to get through resid processing before the end of the season. I'm going to quit in April. I think you've had enough lecturing. It's been since the beginning of the year. Tonight, we're going to cover hydrotreating. I've got a lot to cover, and I also am going to try to cover hydrocracking. Whether we get through hydrocracking or not remains to be seen, but I'm going to take a crack at it. Thank you, man. A hydrocrack at that. I really didn't know where to start. I had so many things I wanted to talk about hydrotreating. You know, if cat cracking is the thoroughbred in the refinery, and reforming is the prima donna, hydrotreating is the workhorse. And there's so much to say about hydrotreating, about the catalyst. An amazing catalyst. The catalyst has been studied for at least 50 years, probably 55, 60. And I'd say we still don't know all there is to know about it, but we still know for sure just why it works. It's still good old cobalt moly after all these years on alumina, although some nickel moly is also used, and depending on the price of the two metals has an influence. Or if you want to remove nitrogen, you might prefer nickel moly. But here's this catalyst that's been around with us for a long time. I really didn't know where to start. Should I tell you about the catalyst first? Should I tell you how easy it is to make and how difficult it is to understand? Do we talk about the processes? Do we talk about the many processes that are possible? Do we talk about the hardware? So I'm going to try to give you a little bit of everything. I thought the first thing I'd do is, since I'm a catalytic chemist by first instinct, I really like to work in the laboratory. Once in a while, if you come around on Saturday afternoon, you'll find me tinkering. I don't get enough time for it, but I really love it. And so I thought maybe a lot of you who will never make a catalyst, I'd let you all participate with me in making a catalyst. So I asked Charlie Nybert, where is Charlie? There he is. I asked him to get me some secret ingredients, and while we're lecturing, I'm going to leave this catalyst be prepared. And this is more like a freshman chemistry laboratory, no offense. I just thought I'd try to convey to you how easy these things are to make. Now, we won't go through the drying and the grinding and the extrusion or the spray drying, but first of all, I'm going to start with alumina. I think I could talk about aluminas for at least 2 hours. I spent a lot of my time working with aluminas. Aluminas are like people. There are no two aluminas in the world alike. As much as people would like to think there are, there must be at least a million different kinds of alumina, and that's being conservative. What I have here is an alumina from Conoco. It's called Catapel. It readily disperses in water. And it's ready made for me, so it'll be easy. I won't have to make my aluminum gel. So I just put it in there, empty it in that beaker of water. And then I'll take my magic potion. Well, first of all, I'll take the magic potion moly trioxide. This particular trioxide is not too reactive. Charlie's going to get me some much more reactive material. Leave that stir for a little bit. I'm going to put in cobalt. And I don't have a glass rod with me. See if I can get this to go down. Okay. What's going to happen, you'd say, how is that purple stuff going to be that blue stuff? And that's what it's going to be, but it won't be that today. I better hang on to that right away. It'll be that way after we dry it, extrude it, and calcine it, turn blue. The reason it turns blue is the blue is cobalt aluminate. And this is cobalt carbonate. Cobalt ion is usually a pinkish color, but with alumina it turns blue. So we're on our way to make a catalytic hydrotreating catalyst. And I've lectured before on these, and I have to get back here for the TV participants. Thank you, Dan. I think I told you before, but I just go through this again because this is another interesting story. As you recall, I told you that the early cobalt carbonate, cobalt molybdate catalysts were very large catalysts of this kind. This is before they understood the value of, or the importance of diffusion, or significance of it, and accessibility and porosity. Then they began to work with pelleted catalysts. You know, the engineers always felt much more comfortable with a pelleted catalyst. They're always worried about it falling apart. This happens to be an old American sign, the pelleted catalyst. It's 3/8 inch a catalyst. I mean, pardon me, 3/16 inch catalyst. Very safe. It won't come apart in the bed, but not very active either because the oil molecules can't get at the active sites very easily. Besides, it's awfully expensive to make. As I point out to you, tableting is a very expensive operation. It's all right if you're making pills for the ill, but when you're making catalysts, it's an awfully expensive operation. So people began to make extrudate, and I had the good fortune of being with Sinclair when they started working with Nalco, and this is a later version, but these were, they began to make extrudate. That's a very tough thing to make, extrudate. Lord knows how many nights I sweat trying to get a hard material coming out of a calciner. And the many times I went into the plant at 2 in the morning and found out they'd pulled the automatic sampler all the way so the production people could make a lot of product, only to run into people like Exxon's quality control people afterwards pointing out to me that our product didn't need crush. Crush is very important. Well, then we started, we took the catalyst from Sinclair to Nalco, this particular version. At that time it was 154, and we went to another catalyst, 1471. This is 1/8 inch extrudate. It shrinks a little bit on manufacture. Very active catalyst. Took a long time to evolve this one, but it was a very good catalyst, and is to this day, as a matter of fact. In hydrotreating, if you're dealing with a gas, you have very little problem of accessibility. On the other hand, if you're dealing with a heavy oil, the oil is in the liquid form, it hits the catalyst, it has to diffuse in, and diffusion, of course, is much slower than liquid phase. If you're dealing with real heavy oils or asphalt teens, then you have a real problem. So one of the things we early learned in reforming, you recall I mentioned in reforming, we learned the value of a small particle in enhancing selectivity and activity. Well, the same thing is true with hydrotreating. The only difference is that for some period of time, most of the hydrotreating was done on lighter stocks. And also, there was concern about putting a liquid through a fixed bed. It was always to put a gas through in reforming, but to put a liquid through in a fixed bed, they were quite concerned about the distribution of the oil and the pressure drop. Well, I think I mentioned to you that we began to work at Nalco with a... I managed to talk the manager into swapping a storage tank for a rubber extruder, and we converted that into a 1/16 inch extruder. And we convinced Exxon that they ought to try 1/16 inch catalyst in their first gas oil hydrotreater at Baytown. They never tried a 1/16, they were scared to death of it. But in this case, the laboratory got a royalty back from any catalyst that was connected with Exxon. And so the laboratory at Exxon encouraged their operating people to try this 1/16 inch. Finally, we got an order for it. We had a very difficult time in making that catalyst. But it went in and it was completely successful. And I told you the story of how, from that point on, I became acquainted with the people of city service and hydrocarbon research. And they were just beginning to think about the H oil process, which is today your H coal process. And they realized the importance of particle size and the structure. And Cy Schumann, who was vice president for research at that time, asked for 16th-inch samples. And finally, we agreed to make him the 32nd-inch sample, which I think you've seen here, I've shown before, which is still, to me, an interesting development. That worked, and that went on to be the catalyst for the H oil process. Later on, they were able to make the 16th work, but this is the one that gave them the incentive. At the same time, people began to find the old Davison people had discovered if they combine nickel and cobalt, they get an unusual catalyst. It's up here somewhere. And they called it nickel mode. And that was the beginning of trying to get nickel into the catalyst rather than cobalt. And then later on, they found that nickel, they found that nickel was more active in removing nitrogen. And so the nickel moly catalysts were born. And they are very useful in many applications, and in cases of hydrocracking also, which if we have time, we'll talk about this evening. Then others began to like the idea of a small extrudate. Here's some nickel moly by American Cyan, but a nickel moly 16th inch. And American Cyan and others got the idea of using a small diffusion limited product, but having a large size, so the pressure drop through the bed wouldn't be quite so great. And the tri-lobe catalyst was born, and I still think that's a brilliant achievement, getting these clover leaf holes drilled into a die plate is no easy matter. And there is even a four-lobe catalyst available now. As I told you also, there was interest in, some people do not like extrudate. They like something that flows, and also there are certain processes where the catalyst does move, and so the microspheric or the spheroidal catalysts were developed. This happens to be an Alco one. It's a good catalyst too. Someone asked me, how come we don't use it? I said, probably because you didn't ask. They'll sell you anything. It isn't proprietary. So that's the story. There, of course, are the nickel tungsten catalysts and tungsten sulfide catalysts, but still cobalt moly is the workhorse followed by nickel moly. Cobalt is getting very expensive, and so nickel does tend to take its place because of that. If you look at our solutions turning a little more purple, and it'll get down to that reddish purple. And if we leave it settle, take it out and dry it, extrude it, we can make a cobalt moly catalyst. Interesting to see how active it is. In your book, I hope all of you brought your book, or at least we're going to go through that a little bit. Chapter 8 on page 115. This cobalt moly catalyst in the hydrogen system, could I have that first slide? Am I hooked up? Basically, all hydrotreating processes are very similar. That's not quite in focus, I don't believe. Treating processes are the same and very basically, very simple setup, really. Your feedstock is heated up, hydrogen recycles brought around, combined. These two go through a heater into the bed. Now, hydrotreating and hydrocracking are exothermic reactions. You recall that hydrocracking, catalytic cracking, is an endothermic reaction, and so is reforming. These are exothermic reactions, so you get temperature rise in the bed. In some processes, particularly if there's a lot of sulfur removed, nitrogen, oxygen, and hydrogenation, and or hydrocracking, you may want to bring some cool hydrogen in some point in the bed to cool the reaction off, and then allow the temperature to rise again. But this is not unlike your little reactors you find in the laboratory. The fixed bed system we have, I don't know, we have about 14 of these reactors, and basically that's all it is. The product goes through a heat exchange to a separator, the recycled gas, usually with some treatment perhaps, it's taken off, and the product's taken over and stabilized. The desulfurized product comes out here overhead, and C3s and lighters to sulfur removal come out here. In the case of resid processing, particularly the H oil, all they did is take this line down the bottom and flow it upstream through this vetted catalyst. And the H coal is essentially the same operation. So even the H coal is not greatly different from this. A little more complex, I guess, Carl, huh? But basically, that's what it is. And with the ebullating bed with H oil, and H coal, because of the potential laydown of coke and metals and other debris, the bed jiggles, continually lifted, and as a result you can bring in fresh catalyst continuously, so it gives you a way of continually regenerating the bed. Otherwise, these catalysts will operate for literally years at a time before they finally foul, depending on the feedstock you're operating on and the nature, whether you're running on a naphtha or a light gas oil, light cycle oil, or a heavy gas oil, or a resid. You can shut this off and purge it with air and burn the carbon off, and then resulfide and reinitiate your processing. In recent years, the time to shut down and burn the carbon off the catalyst, especially when you're dealing with people who only do this once every 2 or 3 years, gets you to a point where you can have some mistakes and some follow-ups, and you're not certain when you're through regenerating that you have regenerated properly. So in the last few years, business has developed in which companies like Catalyst Regeneration Incorporated come in, pick up your catalyst, take it to their regenerating facilities. For example, this one is down Lake Charles. Burn the carbon off there, clean it up, check it to make it's okay, and then bring it back. And now you're assured that the catalyst is going to be all right. We have the capability, of course, of evaluating catalysts, and we frequently on a shutdown and turnaround, we will grab a sample of catalyst and check it to see how good it is. Ron Kamisak and the technologists working with him do that sort of thing. And we've saved a lot of money by showing that the catalyst, if properly regenerated, can be reused. So that's the hydrotreating process. Now, this catalyst is really a workhorse. It does so many things. It does it so easily. By the way, the variables involved here are temperature, pressure, hydrogen to hydrocarbon, the liquid hourly space velocity. These are the main factors, and the size of the catalyst and the activity of the catalyst. Well, as you read in your book, the first reaction is desulfurization. But the next very important reaction, and we do it all the time, those are involved in our shale oil and H coal, where we have a lot of hydrogen, know that they're interested in denitrogenation. If you're working with H coal liquid or shale oil, there's also a lot of oxygen in there, and so deoxygenation is also involved. It's an interesting hydrogenation catalyst. It's not a very active catalyst, nothing like we would consider platinum, palladium, nickel. But it's able to operate in the presence of sulfur and oxygen and nitrogen and garbage. And that's what's so neat about cobalt moly. You know, one time we were seeking a good hydrocracking catalyst for resid, and we tried all kinds of catalysts, silica, aluminum, silicas, the zeolites, nickel, vanadium, all kinds of catalysts. But you know, they'd start out a lot more active, but old cobalt moly starts out less active, but it just keeps chugging along. When all the other catalysts are dead, it's still going right along. It's really amazing. I think when Howard Moore's group started up their aging runs, they had had very little experience, and they'd only run catalysts for a short period of time. And I think they got quite a interesting early exposure as the catalyst went on day after day after day with residual oils like shale oils and H-coal oils, and kept right on working. It's quite an experience when you see it for the first time, especially when you have a bad feed. Another important reaction is the saturation of Conrad's and carbon. And that constitutes a multitude of sins, polynuclear aromatics, asphaltenes. Diolefins, and what else? Another thing that these catalysts are very good at is taking the metal out of a residual oil. And that's where all these resid processes come in. This is another way to get the metals out. As you know, in RCC, we either ignore the metals or we're going to have this MRS process to take them out. With hydrotreating, you take them out by hydrogenation and they deposit on the catalyst. And many people, myself included, have tried to convert the nickel and vanadium into an additional hydrogenation catalyst. But the nickel or vanadium sits in the middle of I'm never sure I draw this right, there's so many of them. Sits in the middle of a porphyrin ring, resonating, and electrons hold this system very stable. This nickel comes from the porphyrins from the hemoglobin and from the chlorophyll of plants and animals. And it starts out iron, as you know, or magnesium, and in time, nickel and vanadium replace those, and these are what you find in our heavy oils. Now this catalyst is able to saturate these rings, this resonating system, and kick out the nickel. That's quite a feat. Or vanadium. And so that's one of the reactions that's very important in any resid processing, and including the H oil, and including H coal. That reaction of hydrogenation of the aromatic ring is quite important in the H-coal process. And that the main mechanism for hydrogenation, the mechanism is based on two kinds of things. One is that these very large molecules of coal will partially dissolve and fragment, presenting a thermally fragment, presenting a free radical. But they can combine with another free radical and form a very large particle, as we've discussed here. However, if you have a hydrogen donor,
If I take naphthalene and I saturate one of these rings, if I saturate one of these rings, put hydrogen there. These hydrogens are very labile. And so if you have these two big molecules with their free radicals jutting out here, and they want to combine, these hydrogens are extremely labile. They come here, pair up, and block that reaction. And what the cobalt moly does in the H-coal is it facilitates this going back and forth between the saturated, or the tetralene, and the unsaturated, or naphthalene, or some of the higher molecular weight polynuclear aromatics. The exon's hydrogen donor process says we will take this cycle oil from here, we will run it through a bed of fixed catalyst, cobalt moly. We will bring tetralene and equivalent back in this bed of ebullating coal and get this conversion. We'll get this hydrogen transfer. The only trouble is, as it goes through this bed, the concentration of hydrogen, if I plot it, goes down like this, so that by the time it gets to the middle of the bed, there's very little hydrogen left. Whereas the H-coal process has that catalyst sitting here, and the tetralene is zinging back and forth real fast. Just a busy little body, like a bee, bumblebee, back and forth, bringing hydrogen to these molecules, and so you have as much hydrogen transfer at the top as you do at the bottom. And you also have a much faster reaction. So this is your hydrotreating catalyst working in an H-coal mode. By the way, the 1/32 inch was light there, but it's a little too easily carried out with the iron pyrites and other ash. And so the 1/16 inch is the catalyst of choice there. The present one is the American cyanide catalyst. I did mention another reaction that's important to understand because it comes up in hydrocracking as well. Was our polynuclear friend, phenanthrene, and other higher molecular weight species. If we run this over a cat cracker, you get zilch, we get coke, it won't crack, the aromatic is stable. It's really in a very high dehydrogenation mode thermodynamically. If we run it over a hydrotreating catalyst, we will get that double bond will saturate. And as I pointed out to you in an early talk, yeah. This is now saturated, and if we pass that over a cat cracker, this will split and we'll get aromatics. In the hydrocracking process, we do both at the same time. We both saturate and crack. And so the value of the hydrocracking process is that it, in one fell swoop, in one unit, does a very similar thing. It saturates the ring in the presence of sulfur and cracks it and gives you also a high octane product and a very high yield because you're putting hydrogen into that system as well. So our friend, we do this all the time in our refinery. We saturate this double bond. We take out some of the sulfur, and that's what goes to our cat cracker. We greatly enhance the reactivity of this feedstock by directing these molecules to valuable products rather than to coke. is, one of the things it's used for is just pre-treating naphtha. Remove the sulfur or any oxygen or nitrogen that might interfere with reforming, and almost every reformer has a hydrotreater ahead of it. The old cobalt moly is really a workhorse in the refinery. Even low boiling molecules are saturated. Their conjugated diolefins can be saturated to prevent them from becoming coke formers or gum formers or color bodies. And as a matter of fact, the same catalyst in a similar process is used to treat wax and lube oil to remove color there and improve their stability. So when you think of hydrotreating, I want you to think of a catalyst that's extremely versatile. It's ambidextrous, it can do almost anything, and it you have to know how to treat it. After a while, you develop a sense of where you would operate with a given feedstock. It also can even be used for reforming. I don't know whether you recall my mentioning the very early autofining process, which operated at a very low hydrogen pressure and actually made hydrogen rather than consuming it. And as a result, it could take the sulfur out while it was making the hydrogen to take the sulfur out. So it was a twist. And again, the cobalt moly catalyst worked very well. As a matter of fact, that was my first exposure to cobalt moly catalyst, was running a lot of tests on the old autofining process. I guess we can turn this off and leave it set on. Come along pretty good. It might get a little more red, I think, if I left. I want it to just settle there a little bit. I better just keep the stirrer on for a while. That hydrotreating is still with us today is a testimonial. I just wanted to read some of the papers that were given at the very latest NPRA meeting in San Antonio. There were a number of them, but our friends from UOP presented a paper on the flexibility of commercially available UOP technology for conversion of residuent distillates. And I think it's also interesting that never once did they mention the RCC process. It was all hydrotreating processes. Here's another paper by UOP. New catalyst permits desulfurization of heavier resids. The Cosden Malaprop process for light hydrocarbon desulfurization. And here's a hydrocracking paper. New zeolite technology for maximum mid-barrel production. And there's a high conversion residuum hydrocracking with the CanMet process. And the Shell Soaker vis breaking, which included a hydrotreating operation. So hydrotreating is with us in a big way. I think you can go through those mechanisms. What I thought would be more helpful to you than the book for the graduate course rather than the undergraduate course, I thought this article from the American Institute of Chemical Engineers Journal, May 1973, would be more helpful. If you'll refer to this paper, let me just go through it with you a little bit to tell you a little of what is in here. I think this is an excellent review of the chemistry as it says. The chemistry and engineering of catalytic hydrodesulfurization. And these are by Schuett. This is by Schuett and Gates from the Department of Chemical Engineering at the University of Delaware. If you start on page 417, I'm just going to walk you through it. I'm not going to pause very long anywhere. I would hope that you would read it for yourself, but I try to highlight some of the things in here. First of all, there's a discussion of the processes.
And if you turn to page 418, you'll see a list of a discussion of the various feedstocks. I forgot to mention the fact that Hydrotreating is also used to stabilize and convert light cycle oil into a heating oil. They have put quite a bit of hydrogen in there and removed the double bonds. And it lists in here the things that I was just talking about. All the hydrodesulfurization, demetallization, saturation, that sort of thing. There's a brief discussion here of the catalyst, and there'll be more discussion later on in this paper. At the top, you also can see, familiarize yourself with the feedstocks there and the molecules that are present in these various feedstocks. It's quite easy to remove a sulfur from a mercaptan. That's what we call a meatball. The disulfides and the sulfides come out easily. Thiophene's a little tougher, and there's a different mechanism for removing nitrogen than sulfur. The sulfur, we think, comes out by the sulfur bond forming with the moly itself, whereas with nitrogen, you have to saturate the bond before you spring it loose. Benzothiophene is more difficult, and you begin to get into steric hindrance then. And things like dibenzothiophene are a lot more difficult. And the benzonaphthiophenes, even more difficult. And as this sulfur, as this polynuclear aromatic ring gets bigger and bigger, the sulfur gets tucked in behind, and it becomes more difficult to remove the sulfur. The bottom of that page, and there's a discussion on reactors and processing conditions. And not only are you involved in processing conditions, but that is the activity, the temperature you can afford, the space velocity, the pressure. But you also have to deal with slow deactivation, particularly if you're dealing with a very heavy feedstock. And so there's a discussion down the bottom there of the problems of aging. One way you get around aging, of course, is to increase the hydrogen pressure. The higher the hydrogen pressure, the better you protect the catalyst. Also, you get into a lot of more subtle questions, the type of support. I'll take this off, see if it'll cool down. Type of support, the porosity, how you build your dual pore structure. The bigger the molecules, the better, the more important it is that you have an avenue by which these molecules can reach the active sites. On the other hand, there is some work that shows you may also want to exclude the very heaviest molecules, which plug the catalyst pores. And there are patents on both sides of that argument, some arguing for large pores and others arguing for very select pores. Well, this paper gets more detailed, and I think that you'll find on page 420, at table 3, showing the reaction rate. With the various catalyst compositions. Table 4, showing the product distribution. A comparison with chromium, which has quite a different activity, not nearly as much activity as cobalt moly. The diagram of the reaction mechanism there is, if you want more detail, I think is an interesting one, showing that the first removal, and there's some further information on that later on in this article, showing that the sulfur is first removed, still leaving the diolefin, which is then hydrogenated, to either a monoolefin or a saturate. And this section is a very good article if you want to learn more about that. And page 422, we go into a discussion of kinetics. And generally, we found that for the chemist, if you plot the inverse of space velocity versus the log of the fraction remaining, you get a straight line. For the engineer who has to be concerned with more subtle factors, it may become a second order reaction depending on the conditions. You see Arrhenius plots there also. As you go on, the discussion gets into the effect of hydrogen, and you'll see that. And also some discussion of Liberty reactions as you get into a high molecular weight molecules. And the role of diffusion in that part of the reaction. Then there's discussion on catalysts, and there you get into for example, on page 425, you'll see the oxygen is packed in a what we would call a tetrahedral configuration. If you put four spheres together in that form, you will have a tetrahedral hole in the middle. On the surface, that tetrahedral hole is a point where the alumina can settle in, the small aluminum ion. And by the same token, so can a cobalt ion. As I mentioned, alumina is a fascinating material, and the various faces of alumina present different rearrangements of oxygen, giving both tetrahedral holes and octahedral holes. An octahedral hole is where four oxygens are sitting directly on top of four other oxygens, and that hole in the center of that, you can picture four billiard balls touching, and four below, that hole in the center, is an octahedral hole. Also on 426, it reminds you there of the various species of alumina. It's a pretty simplified diagram. Actually, you can vary the composition of alumina by varying the ratio of any one of these, and also the crystallite size of any one of these. And the alumina that we discovered, the randomite, is not even listed. So there's another trihydrate not listed here, only barite and gibbsite. But there is a material called randomite or van Oordstrandite. As you calcine these various original forms of alumina, such as the gelatinous, or we call that pseudobaymite, the barite, the crystalline baymite, and the gibbsite, and the van Oordstrandite, you will get different surfaces depending on eta, whether it goes to eta, theta, gamma, some of the other aluminas. And of course, again, the outer surface of those crystals present surfaces upon which the cobalt moly deposit. The cobalt moly is dependent on the support for at least surface area and preferred catalyst. Alumina has always been the best support. Any other support has never shown the performance of alumina. By the way, our catalyst is now settling down. You see the there is some cobalt ion in solution. As a matter of fact, there will be some moly, molybdate ion in solution, and there will be polymers of molybdate complexing with cobalt. So there are a number of species in that solution. If I had kept this on a little longer, this would have become a deeper purple. But I imagine that would make a pretty fair catalyst. Take the water, take the solution off, and rework that if you're commercial. Don't want to throw that away. Filter it, spray, flash dry it, grind it, extrude it, and you have a catalyst. On page 429, there's a discussion of the molybdate interaction with alumina. As I say, we don't have time to walk you through this entire paper, but I think if you would take the time to read it, you would begin to obtain a real appreciation of the beauty and complexity of that catalyst. There's some discussion of the nickel moly catalyst. And on page 432, you can see the effect of varying the metal, cobalt, zinc, nickel, and manganese, to the moly. We usually found that about 3.5% cobalt and 12% moly is in a good range, weight percent. Figure 21 is a better description of how one could visualize the metal interacting, the moly interacting with the sulfur and pulling it in and leaving the hydrocarbon behind. There's a nice discussion here on page 434 of mass transfer effects. And I know that some of you have thought that I was a real bear on packing of reactors, and I am. And the reason for it is that I wasted a lot of my youth in making runs that I later learned had no significance because one could not fully control the residence time of the oil in the reactor. And so I early learned that I had to pack that bed full, fill the void space between catalyst particles, so that I would get a good pressure drop, and so that my liquid would flow as a piston down through the bed rather than draining down this side or that side and having no control of residence time. When you do that, you have very poor correlation. You have very poor relationship between space velocity and sulfur removal. And also, if you're working on lube oil, color, stability, and a lot of other things. And that's where I first ran into the problems of controlling residence time of bed, was with lube oil. So I learned to pack those beds in order to get this piston flow. And the problem is only one of the laboratory experimentation. In the commercial unit, the velocities, the linear velocities of the gases, the hydrogen, and the oil are so much greater that the pressure drop is quite great across the bed. And one does get a true spreading of the oil, if properly done, so that you do have control of residence time. You do get a piston flow. But in the laboratory, it's a very difficult thing. And I know some of you have had frustration in trying to understand what was going on. One of the first things I saw when I came here, I was reading a report by Carl Jewett, in which he plotted nitrogen removal versus sulfur removal. And when I saw the shape of the curve, I was immediately concerned that he wasn't getting good contract time, and we set about to improve that so that our data that we get in the laboratory can be used by engineers with some degree of confidence extrapolating to a commercial operation. As far as the discussion about catalyst aging, there's a beautiful description of the asphaltene molecule. Is Bob Wombles here tonight? Bob, Bob, I didn't realize it. You know, Harold Boyther drew this thing in 1966. The first time we picked up that structure, I think, was that Alberta paper, wasn't it? And those guys swiped it from Boyther. And I thought they were being original. Harold Boyther, by the way, has worked in, as far as I know, at Gulf Oil from 1950 to today, and still, I believe, still works in hydrotreating and hydrodesulfurization, that sort of thing. He's a real authority on it. There's a list here of catalysts for hydrotreating of residua, and those processes in their own right are, you know, quite complex. We've talked about them. There's a section here about reactor stability, the problems of controlling temperature when you're dealing with a reaction that's exothermic. It can take off on you. The hotter it gets, the faster it goes, and the faster it goes, the hotter it gets. And as you recall, we had a reactor or explosion down here a few years, about a year and a half, 2 years ago, in a similar situation in the reformer. Well, I've got some slides here yet, but they're all the process. Let
Maybe we can, I think it's, we've all seen that. Nitrogen removal, oxygen removal. By the way, oxygen is about as tough as nitrogen. They're both much tougher than sulfur. Sulfur will come out, you can get 90% sulfur out before you get about 15% nitrogen out, 20%. Bill Sutton can attest to that in our shale oil work. That nitrogen is a real bugaboo. I forgot to mention that there are other things in the feedstock too you want to take out if you happen to be there. Chlorides, which are undesirable in many cases. And hydrogenation, hydrocracking. Okay. I just wanted to remind you again of these processes. Go back, you know, to your handbook. I'm sure you probably didn't bring it, but this starts on page 122. And I just wanted to remind you again of how many processes there are. Dewaxing. All these are designed to one thing or another. Quite a variety of processes. Ferrofining. Ferrofining reminds me that one of the things we tried to do, in the early days, working on a Venezuelan crude, which is very high in nickel and vanadium, it was so high that the catalyst fills up with metal so fast that that's why you need an ebullating bed. And by the way, we also went to an ebullating bed at that time to solve the same problem. But another way was to use iron ore, high surface area iron ore as a catalyst to take the metals out. We obtained some patents on that, and that's a pretty effective way. Then you can take the iron ore and send it to a steel mill afterwards, because it now has nickel and vanadium on it, which you need in steel manufacture anyhow. So there's gulf fining, a resid fine, there's a resid, there's gulf fining. Higher boiling stock, a lower boiling stock. Gulf finishing for, say, lube oils or heating oils. There's the HO process, the little reactor, and all this stuff coming after it. It's just like the H coal plants in Carl. I've forgotten whose that is even, HPI. I think that's Chevron. There's a fixed bed hydrodesulfurization that I told you about. Remember the moving bed here when the catalyst does come down through? And the trickle flow where the oil trickles in such a way as to get a long residence time in the bed. And by the way, if you have trickle flow, you just wet the surface of the catalyst particle, then the oil has a lot less diffusion distance. Tube oil hydrotreating. This is if you have coker gas oil, coker naphthas for hydrogenation. You have bond. Everybody's got a hydrodesulfurization process. That's Union Oil, of course, has done a lot of pioneering work in hydrogenation. They work with naphthenic crudes most of the time. They have different problems out there, like hydrocracking, for example, is much more interesting to them than it is to someone working with a paraffinic stock. And even waste oil refining. Wax hydrofinishing. Okay. I want to get through those others, so I'm just going to hold you a few minutes and talk a little bit about hydrocracking. I have not worked much in hydrocracking in recent years. There's been a tremendous development there. In fact, at one time it was thought that the hydrocracking would replace catalytic cracking in the early 60s. Because you do get a great big increase in yield and you get the catalytic cracking product distribution. The only trouble is it's very expensive and the hydrogen is very expensive. You do get a considerable increase in yield. For example, you can get 110 to 120 volume percent yield if you put enough hydrogen in and you lower the molecular weight, so you lower the gravity, so you get a greater expansion. Remember I said the cat cracker was a barrel expander and the Reformer was a barrel shrinker. Well, a hydrocracker is also a barrel expander. As is hydrotreating, by the way, too. Among other things, hydrotreating does increase the API or the lower the specific gravity, so you do get an increase in volume. In hydrocracking, we have our old friends, all the catalytic cracking reactions. Remember the carbonium ion shifts and the methyl groups move around and so forth. There's not as much olefin present, obviously, because you're in a hydrogen atmosphere. But you can run for months and months and months on a hydrocracking catalyst, much as a hydrotreating catalyst, because the hydrocracking catalyst really is a combination, as I pointed out, of the cobalt moly hydrotreating catalyst, or a cleanup with hydrotreating catalyst of the cobalt moly type, followed by a precious metal zeolite type of catalyst, our friend the catalytic cracking catalyst, with some hydrogen to protect it, that hydrogen furnished by a precious metal. By the way, there's an error in the book. When it talks about hydrocracking, it talks about rare earths. It should be talking about precious metals. Although there are some hydrocracking catalysts where the zeolite is stabilized with rare earth, most of them are not. Also, not all the hydrocracking catalysts are made with a zeolite catalyst. Some of them are made with just a silica alumina catalyst. Some of them have cobalt moly in with the zeolite. Some of them have precious metal. Some of them clean up the front end, take out the nitrogen. Nitrogen is a poison for the hydrocracking catalyst as it neutralizes the acidic site. So they're a combination of these processes. I think we have not done much hydrocracking work here, and I want to get that experience into our laboratory. And I finally saw a need for it. Howard Moore has been working with H-coal liquids, and he's got a 400 to 600 cut. And he said, hey, if I hydrotreat that, I put over a cat cracker, I'm going to make high-octane gasoline. The only thing I think that Howard may find is that that particular group of hydrocarbons in there that contain tetralin and decalin will dehydrogenate very rapidly. So he may not get the cracking that he'd hoped. He may not get the splitting out of the rings, but get going back to aromatics and therefore coke. In a case where you have a lot of polynuclear aromatics, it's a natural setup, and that's where hydrocracking is particularly good. And I do that before, but remember now also we can have anthracene as well as phenanthrene, and I think that makes it easy. Well, I can do either one. But remember, I guess I missed one there. Remember I said in cat cracking you go this way, in hydrotreating cat cracking you go this way. In hydrocracking, this molecule it's in a hydrogen atmosphere, it wants to be hydrogenated, it's high pressure. Thermodynamically, it's set up for hydrogenation. Between 600 degrees and 850 degrees, you know, about 800 degrees, and the range of 1,000 to 3,000 pounds hydrogen, these aromatic molecules want to drive to a saturated condition. When you get above about 800, 850, you have to have very high pressure or they want to dehydrogenate. And H-coal incidentally rides right on the edge. It wants to hydrogenate and yet it wants to dehydrogenate. It's kind of a delicate balance. Much more delicate, I think, than people realize. But in hydrocracking, you first saturate that ring again, you split this, and out comes your high octane aromatics. When they talk about resin, they talk about hydrocracking, they frequently are talking about cobalt moly without any acidity, but running at such a high temperature that you actually get thermal cracks. And I think a little bit of cracking, I've never proven this, I guess probably the work has been done or shown. I've always felt that there can be some acidity. Yeah. From this moly, cobalt moly complex with a sulfur group, that this mercaptide group can also give some acidity, a little bit of cracking along a carbonium ion mechanism. I haven't had a chance to study that for a long time. I don't know what's been done in that area. So maybe you get a little bit of catalytic cracking in a hydrotreating catalyst. But at a very high boiling material, when you're going along fighting the acidity, the nitrogen, all this stuff, all you want is that thermal crack, and that's what you get in coal, that's what you get in resid tree. When you get down these lower fragments, 400 to 600 to 800, 900, that's when saturation followed by cracking almost simultaneously, a dual site mechanism again, gives you an ideal product. And that's what hydrocracking is all about. I'm sorry, I don't have any hydrocracking catalysts. It's one of the few areas that escaped me. There you see how this happens to be anthracene being saturated, being split, and then coming down into high octane fragments, and some isobutane also formed depending on one of these fragments out here. I'd say the pioneers in hydrocracking of the zeolite type. I like to think I'm a pioneer in hydrocracking with coal moly, but not in hydrocracking with zeolites and silica alumas. Our silica alumas with hydrocracking just did not work on resid hydrocracking. They just were saturated too quickly. But Standard California, Union Oil has been one of the pioneers. And you know, Union Oil is a company not as bigger than ours. And if that company can become a pioneer and a leader, you know, certainly there's no reason why we can't become an equal leader. Gulf Oil has pioneered a lot. Standard of Indiana has done a lot of work with their ultra-cracking process. Now, hydrocarbon research, now we get into the hydro-treating type of hydrocracking. And Shell Development has a hydrocracking process. I'm not familiar with Bodish's cracking process, but that was done in conjunction with IFP. Probably a pretty good one. And basically, it's very similar to the bed. It's a fixed bed. The only difference is it's even more exothermic reaction, so you have to be even more concerned with keeping the bed cool, watching runaway conditions. And so generally, they're designed to either come in, take a little crack, cool. It would be nice to hook up a reformer here, wouldn't it? That was when one's cooling, the other be heating. And then go back into another bed, or bring in hydrogen into that bed, cool. This is the amount of hydrogen required, as hydrocracking takes a lot of hydrogen, as you can well imagine. And that is a real drawback. Hydrogen is now, I don't know what they figured out, maybe $3 or 1,000 cubic feet, maybe $4.50. I don't know, I've heard a number of numbers. Hydrogen is very expensive, so if you're beginning to put in, you know, maybe a couple thousand cubic feet per barrel, you've already bitten off, you know, $4 to $8 a barrel. So that's one of the drawbacks. On the other hand, you have gained 20 to 30% of barrels of oil, which are worth $40 a barrel in naphtha, high octane naphtha, 45, 48. It's going up all the time. You can't keep track of it. These are the knees in hydrocracking, very similar to the knees in catalytic cracking. You get so much conversion, and then you start getting secondary cracking. In much of our work in shale oil, we take advantage of that, what we call cascading. We crack, cascade some down, get rid of it, take some more off. And I call that a cascading reaction. This shows how the gravity comes down, K-factor comes down and back up with temperature as you start to hydrogenate and hydrocrack. Well, I think that I've kept you long enough. I would hope that would give you some idea of hydrotreating and hydrocracking. What do you think about our lecture next week? It's a day before a holiday. Is it a good idea or bad? I've had mixed emotions about it. Let's take a vote. How many would like to have a talk next week? How many would not? Okay. Well, we'll have it. I'm going to be gone the week after Easter, so maybe we'll only get two more lectures in this year. Maybe we'll try to cover alkylation and resid processing in one session. Okay, so